honorary consul, Mr. Vasilis Takas, all the presidents, the deputy presidents, the leaders of the different business formations, ladies and gentlemen, this is my first visit to Thessaloniki, and I'm really impressed. It is beautiful, and I have been received so well. For yesterday and today, I had all rolled into one. I had the best mayor, the best tourist guide, the best investment marketing officer, in the form of Mr. Takas taking me around and telling me everything about the city and the region. You know, our country at one stage has gone through a very dark period, politically, economically. And I think always when it happens to a country, it's important that outside people must be able to tell you, even if you, who are in the middle of a situation, think the future looks dark, other people actually see the opportunities in your country. And I think there are wonderful opportunities in Greece and wonderful opportunities in Thessaloniki and in this region. Now, when I arrived here before the time, I just talked to some of the leaders, and one of the leaders said to me, he said, you know, here in this region and in this city, we have an external mind. We are always looking at the rest of the world. And that is why I'm very glad to be here today. Because discussions of this nature, they're only worth something if it is mutually beneficial. And that is why when we have discussions of this nature, we want people to understand that, yes, we are here to convince people that South Africa is a good investment destination. There are opportunities to go there, start companies, to get new partners, to invest, to make money, because that is what it is about when one is a businessman or a businesswoman. But we also want South African companies and individuals to come here, to Greece, to Thessaloniki, to find partners, to form joint ventures with companies here, and to make money, and to be successful here, and to create jobs. So that is how we look at working together. If it's not a two-way street, it will never survive over the longer term. Now, Mr. Mavridis, many of you know him, he's our trade officer. He will give you a presentation about all the detail, the opportunities, the sectors, the incentives, the support programs from the side of government, the tax incentives, all of that. What I will do very briefly is just to tell you what the political and economic context is in the country. But I want to start with our continent, Africa. First, a number of the presidents and vice presidents refer to Africa as a continent. Now, we know that when many people look at the continent of Africa, they don't quite know if they should take the risk of investing there. And yes, there are still some of the individual countries that must sort out their internal stability, become democracies, and become growing economies. But there's only a few of them. By far the majority of African countries are democracies now. Democracies in the Western sense of the word, with functioning multi-party democracies, elections, free media, and more connections between countries. But you know, we're very often when we look at the world, we look at China, India, and say, that's where the future opportunities are. Many of the opportunities are there. But we also know that economies have their ups and downs. Look at what is happening in China now. And people are looking at India and people are saying, you know, the real economy of the future, that's India. Because just look at the middle class, because it is the middle class that consume, that create jobs, that create this surge, this opportunity for growth. On the African continent, the middle class is far bigger than the middle class in India. It is something that many people, I would say most people in the West, don't know. The African middle class is growing rapidly. 5 of the 15 fastest growing economies of the past 3 years is African countries. And some of them is from a lower base, but the economic growth is there. And on the African continent, there is massive, rapid urbanization at the moment. People are moving to cities from the rural areas. And you all know, you're a mature economy, but in economies where that happens, everything changes. Consumer pattern changes. People start to eat differently. They want more consumer products. More infrastructure is needed. And that is where our continent is at the moment, with massive opportunities. Now South Africa, briefly. Mr. Fakas has been, as he briefly referred, our honorary consul since 1994 when President Mandela became president. And since then, we've been a democracy with a very strong constitution, good stability, all the institutions of democracy functioning very, very well. We have a majority party in the country that has a support of around 60%, so there's stability. We have independent courts, and those courts don't favor anyone. We have institutions, unlike most democracies, that we created because we said in a country like ours, where not everybody can afford to approach the courts to get very expensive lawyers, there must be mechanisms to fight all crimes, all kinds of corruption. And we have created a number of these constitutional mechanisms that are independent of any political influence. We have a public protector, which is a high-powered lawyer, independent, with the ability to investigate anybody from the president down to any citizen and to make public the findings. We have a human rights commission to look at the human rights of everybody in South Africa, citizens, foreigners, everybody alike. And if the human rights are abused, are trampled on, then action is taken. And one area where we are very proud of what we are achieving, there are some women here tonight. We feel very strongly about the emancipation of women. And our parliament is almost 50% women, not because we have an official quota, but because all of us believe that it is the right thing to do. Our cabinet, 50% women. In our courts, we want 50% women. We're not there yet, but that is where we are moving. And we want on the boards of our companies, we want women on the boards of our companies. Not because we think it's superficial, but because we know if you don't do that, there's a lot of intellectual capacity that you just leave out there not to be utilized. In terms of our economy, the four strongest sectors, manufacturing, mining, agriculture, and tourism, and there are a few niche sectors that Mr. Mavridis will refer to, like renewable energy, where there are wonderful opportunities in a country like ours. And ours is it's a developing country. It's an African country, but it is a very modern African country. In the 80s, and we never know if we should be proud of it, because it was for the wrong reason, but South Africa was already had a nuclear arsenal. So we decided unilaterally, voluntarily, to dismantle that in the mid-90s. We have wonderful infrastructure. We have one of the most advanced, most respected banking systems in the world. That's the kind of country we are. We're also a country where there is a difference, too huge in our minds, between the rich people who have and the people who do not have. And therefore, as a government, we understand that the only way that you can solve that is not by more government intervention and by taking from some and giving to the others. In order to be able to take a little bit and give to others, you must create wealth. And that's why we regard the private sector as the absolute number one priority in achieving just that. Now, I think those are the broad brushstrokes. I know that we will take some questions, and if there are any detailed questions, I will be happy to answer that. Thank you very much.